is on a very, very popular request because I know that this is a new guideline and it's a very big guideline to be finished in one day. Somehow remember that the recommendations that are given in this guideline are the only important things that you should be knowing, except for few numbers here and there throughout the guideline. Now the recommendations are around 3 pages in the main guideline, and it's really difficult to sort out the most important recommendations from the most important recommendations. So I had no choice than to put all the recommendations in front of you and to read out them for you so that you can just go through it and key, or you may just keep your earplugs on and listen to this recording whenever you're doing your duty or you're doing any other work at home. So I want to apologize before only because it is going to be a lengthy session. I'm really sorry I could not cut it short because none of the things are unimportant in amongst the recommendations. And bear with me, guys. So this is actually a BIVA guideline, and it tells you about the psychological issues around HIV and pregnancy. That's the most important thing that the NHS is concerned about. And they have said that antenatal HIV care should be delivered by the multidisciplinary team, which will involve the physicians, the obstetricians, the nurses. So it all includes the most important staff from all the types of departments that are required. Pregnant women living with HIV are offered peer support where available. So this is the most frequent thing that we come across, that HIV is considered to be, it is the people specifically who have this HIV go through a lot of loneliness and trauma because of the social pressures. So they are offered peer support by NHS. So that these are the few important things in the start. The main thing that comes in here is the perinatal mental health assessment. The assessment is done two times. One is in the antenatal part and one is in the postnatal. So assessment of antenatal and postnatal depression should be undertaken. It should be undertaken at booking, again at 4 to 6 weeks postpartum, and again at 3 to 4 months postpartum. Because these are the areas and these are the weeks when patient will be mostly inclined towards getting depressed at the start of pregnancy if the patient doesn't want it. Also because of the fear of transmitting it to the baby. And in the postpartum period, we know that postpartum period has been most likely associated with depression amongst women. Something like baby blues and postpartum depression, they come along, and someone with HIV tends to have it more frequently. So three times, one at booking, one at 4 to 6 weeks, and one at 3 to 4 months postpartum. About the sexual health screening, it is recommended for pregnant women newly diagnosed with HIV. So someone who has come with diagnosis of HIV, you do the sexual health screening, send the patient to the sexual health clinic. For women living with HIV and already engaged in HIV care who become pregnant, sexual health screening is suggested. Okay, so a patient with HIV and now she has become pregnant, sent to the sexual health clinic. genital tract infections should be treated according to the BASH guidelines. So we know the treatments of the sexually transmitted infections that are already there, and the other type of infections which are not sexually transmitted, like bacterial vaginosis and other things. And the treatment should be given according to the BASH guidelines, and we know that from those guidelines itself. Now, the guideline takes you towards how to manage these patients at the start. Pregnant women who are newly diagnosed with HIV do not require any additional baseline investigations compared to the non-pregnant women living with HIV, other than those routinely performed in the general antenatal clinic. So there are no extra investigations required for a newly diagnosed HIV pregnant patient. HIV resistance testing should be completed and results available prior to initiation of treatment, except for late presenting women. Okay, so what do we do? We do the HIV resistance testing. Okay. And this should be started, this should be done before initiation of the treatment, okay? Except for in patients who come late. And how late? They come after 28 weeks. So do not do this HIV resistance because they're already late in their pregnancy to come to you, and already late to have transmitted the virus if not taken the treatment. And it's really important for these women to start the treatment as soon as possible, right? Women should be encouraged to continue combination. That means CART, that is combination antiretroviral therapy post-delivery. But where they choose to stop CART, a further resistance test is recommended to ensure that mutations are not missed with reversion during the off treatment period. So we do HIV resistance test at the start of the treatment, so before starting that, and then we do another one if the patient wants to stop CART after delivery. In women conceiving on CART, there should be minimum of one CD4 cell count at baseline and one at delivery. So we do CD4 cell count two times, baseline one and one at delivery. In women who commence CART in pregnancy, a CD4 cell count should be performed as per routine initiation of CART with the addition of CD4 count at delivery, even if starting at CD4 count more than 350 cells per mm³. So when do we do this? We have seen that in women who commence CART in pregnancy. That means they did not require any CART before that. So those who have started CART, in them, the CD4 count should be done as per the routine initiation that we have seen. And again, in addition of the CD4 count at delivery, even if starting at CD4 more than 350. Okay, clear? So there's another set of women in women who commence CART in pregnancy, and HIV viral load should be performed 2 to 4 weeks after commencing the treatment, at least once every trimester at 36 weeks and at delivery. Okay, so we have seen about the CD4 count in women who conceived when they were on CART. So there we do it two times, one at baseline, one at delivery. In women who start CART when pregnant, there it should be done at the initiation of the CART and again at delivery, even if the CD4 count is more than 350. And the HIV viral load in patients who start with CART in pregnancy, it should be done after 2 to 4 weeks of starting the CART, Okay, so we want to see how much the cart has affected the viral load. And then we do it once every trimester. And then at 36 weeks, and then at delivery. In women commencing CART in pregnancy, liver function test should be performed as a routine initiation of CART, and then with each routine blood test. So we do LFTs at the start of the CART, and then with every routine blood test. In the event that women who has initiated CART during the pregnancy has not suppressed plasma viral load to less than 50 HIV RNA copies, the following interventions are recommended. Review adherence, perform resistance test if appropriate, consider therapeutic drug monitoring, optimize the best regimen, and consider intensification.
This conference will now be recorded.
So I hope you have got this, that what are the things, what are the interventions that you have to do when the plasma viral load has not suppressed to less than 50 in women who has initiated CART during pregnancy. Okay, so what are you doing when you're reviewing the adherence? You are including a full exploration of the potential impacting factors and the concomitant medication. Okay, so we have to see the adherence. We have to perform a resistance test if appropriate. And we have seen about the drug monitoring, which is really important to see that. And which one is the best regimen for that patient that should be reviewed. And then if the drugs are falling short, to reduce the viral load, intensification of the drugs may be required. It is recommended that women conceiving on an effective CART regimen should continue this treatment. The exceptions are non-standard regimen. So women who are not there on standard regimens may not continue, sorry for that, may not conceive on effective CART. Okay, the regimens that have been demonstrated to show lower pharmacokinetics in pregnancy, such as darunavir, cobicistat, and elvitegravir, cobicistat, or where there is absence of pharmacokinetic data, such as for raltegravir, 1,200 milligrams once daily. It should be taken, it can be taken either OD or it should be administered 400 milligrams twice daily, or BD, that means BD. This should be modified to include one or more agents that cross the placenta. Okay, so the patients who are there on these regimens, you may stop the treatment, you may ask them to discontinue. A woman conceiving on dolutegravir should see her physician as soon as possible to discuss the current evidence on neural tube defects. That means the patients who were on dolutegravir may have some problems of neural tube defects, and that is why you will have to tell them to discontinue the CART, and they should be seen by a physician. So this table tells us about the women who have conceived when they were taking CART. Then they can continue the CART unless and until they have the drugs which can affect their pregnancy and affect the dose levels in pregnancy. So these are the two exceptions that we have seen. Women who is not already on CART, when to start CART. Okay, so a pregnant lady has been diagnosed with HIV. Now when to start CART? or lady who's been on HIV, who's been already diagnosed HIV and not taking card, maintaining her HIV viral load without any treatment, what when to start a treatment. All the pregnant women, including the allied controllers, they should start the ART during pregnancy and be advised to continue lifelong treatment. What are the allied controllers? The allied controllers are the people who have HIV but maintain a very low viral load, around less than 50, without any treatment. Okay? So even these allied controllers, are when they become pregnant, they should be told to start ART to reduce the maternal to child transmission. All women not on CART should commence CART as soon as they are able to do so in the second trimester, where the baseline viral load is less than 30,000 HIV RNA copies per ml. Okay? Second is, at the start of the second trimester or as soon as possible thereafter, in women with a baseline viral load of 30,000 to 100,000 HIV RNA copies per ml. Third is, within the first trimester, if the viral load is more than 100,000 HIV RNA copies per ml and or the CD4 cell count is less than 200 cells per mmq. So all the women should have commenced CART by 24 weeks of pregnancy. Okay, so when to start CART? They should be started before 24 weeks of pregnancy. Women who is not on CART, what to start? Women are recommended to start tenofovir DF or abacavir with emtricitabine or lamivudine as a nucleoside backbone. Guys, all these things are very new and these were not there in the previous guidelines. So it's really important to remember these new points. What to start? You have to start tenofovir DF or abacavir with emtricitabine or lamivudine. It is recommended that the third agent in CART should be efavirenz or atazanavir, as these agents with the most safety data in pregnancy, which are the efavirenz and atazanavir. So you may use any of these two as the third agent. Rilpivirin, raltegravir, darunavir may be used as alternative third agents. Darunavir should be prescribed at the twice daily dose, around 600 by 100 milligrams BD. If no resistance and consideration should be given to using higher dose if darunavir is initiated in pregnancy. So whenever you are giving darunavir, you have to remember that this one requires a higher dose when given in pregnancy. Dolutegravir, which is 50 milligrams OD, may be considered after 8 weeks of gestation, which must be confirmed. So remember about this dolutegravir, starting after 8 weeks only. Zidovudine monotherapy is not recommended and should only be used in women declining CART with a viral load of less than 10,000 HIV RNA copies per ml and willing to have caesarean section. PI monotherapy, that is protease inhibitor monotherapy, tenofovir, alafenamide, darunavir, cobicistat, elivitegravir, cobicistat are not recommended in pregnancy. It is recommended that the integrase inhibitor-based regimen be considered as a third agent of choice in pregnancy. with high baseline viral load. That means more than 100,000 HIV RNA copies per ml, where CARD is failing to suppress the virus. Okay, so use the integrase inhibitor-based regimen as third choice where CART is not suppressing or it's failing to suppress the virus and the baseline viral load is very high, more than 100,000 RNA copies. Okay, so got it? I think they have given you the whole regimen about what are the important drugs. Though you are not the one who will be starting, it's the specific HIV clinic people who will be dealing with those patients. I think they have added this to this guideline so that you all know the basic drugs that should be started and the dose of everyone so that you remember which one is really not working well. Also, to remember which one can be really teratogenic or harmful in pregnancy. You need not remember the dosage of every drug. Try to remember some very few important ones. Try to remember the regimens at least. Now about the late presenting women not on treatment. A woman who presents after 28 weeks should commence CART without delay because she is already very late. If the viral load is unknown or more than 100,000 copies, a 3 or 4 drug regimen that includes raltegravir is suggested. Management of an untreated woman presenting in labor at term. So how to manage an untreated woman coming in labor? All women should be given a start dose of nevirapine. So as soon as she comes, give a dose of nevirapine 200 milligrams. Second thing, commence oral cyclobutadiene 300 milligrams and lamivudine 150 milligrams BD. Third thing, raltegravir 400 milligrams BD and receive intravenous cyclobutadiene for the duration of labor. Okay, so these are the four things. Remember, nevirapine start dose, oral cyclobutadiene, lamivudine, raltegravir 400 BD and IV cyclobutadiene throughout the labor. In the preterm labor, if infant is unlikely to be able to absorb oral medication, consider the addition of double dose tenofovir, that is DF, tenofovir DF, to the woman's treatment. Women presenting in labor with spontaneous rupture of membranes requiring delivery without a documented HIV result must be advised to have an urgent HIV test. A reactive positive result must be acted upon immediately with initiation of interventions to prevent the vertical transmission of HIV without waiting for further or formal serological confirmations. So, whenever she comes in labor and she has got membranes already and she is requiring a delivery and there has been no documented HIV result, for the safety, always do an urgent HIV test. Okay. What are the pharmacokinetics of antiretrovirals in pregnancy? No routine dose alterations are recommended for antiretrovirals during pregnancy if used at standard adult license doses, apart from raltegravir, which should be given 400 milligrams BD. Okay, so you have to remember this number, this dose, raltegravir 400 milligrams. Consider TDM. That means therapeutic dose monitoring, particularly if combining tenofovir DF and atazanavir. If dosing is off license, consider switching to standard dosing regimen throughout the pregnancy and regular therapeutic dose monitoring. Okay, so these are about the pharmacokinetics of antiretrovirals. Now about the stopping of ART. Now stopping of ART after delivery is not recommended. Women who wish to stop ART should be counseled on the risks and managed as per the VIVA guidelines for treatment of HIV positive adults with antiretroviral therapy. Okay, so it is not recommended, and those who want to stop it should be counseled and then do it as according to the clinic's protocols. HIV2, case discussion with experts with experience of managing HIV2 is recommended for all women. So you need to discuss this with the experts. Now we know that HIV is very well connected and goes hand in hand with hepatitis. So they have also included patients who have the co-infections, HIV and hepatitis. About the HBV, that is hepatitis B virus, on diagnosis of new HBV infection, confirmation of viremia with quantitative HBV DNA, E antigen status, as well as hepatitis A virus, HCV and HDV screening and tests to assess the hepatic inflammation, fibrosis and liver functions are recommended. So whenever you find that there is a new HBV infection, you always check the quantity of HBV DNA, you check the E antigen status, and you check whether the patient has got HAV, HCV, HDV, so screen for other hepatitis, and we see also whether there is any inflammatory or fibrotic changes in the liver. So do LFT. LFT should be repeated at 2 to 4 weeks after commencing ART to detect evidence of hepatotoxicity or immune reconstitution, inflammatory syndrome, that means IRIS, and then monitored regularly throughout the pregnancy and postpartum. So one test 2 to 4 weeks after the treatment, starting of the treatment, and then monitored regularly throughout the pregnancy and postpartum. Because there is no evidence of any adverse effect on maternal or neonatal health if women become pregnant while taking ART, dually active against HBV treatment, should be continued. Tenofovir DF and emtricitabine or lamivudine should form the backbone of antiretroviral regimen in treatment naive patients with wild HIV, HBV, co-infection and no contraindications to any of these drugs. So what is the regimen? Regimen is tenofovir DF plus emtricitabine or lamivudine. If tenofovir DF is not currently part of CART, it should be added. So it's really important to have tenofovir in patients who have got hepatitis with HIV. Lamivudine emtricitabine may be omitted from antiretroviral regimen and tenofovir DF given as a sole anti-HBV agent if there is clinical or genotypic evidence of lamivudine emtricitabine resistant HBV. So if lamivudine and emtricitabine are not there, if they have good resistance, it's okay, but do not miss on tenofovir DF and give it as a sole anti-HBV agent, right? Lamivudine emtricitabine should not be used as the only active drug against HBV in CART because the likelihood of emergent HBV resistance to these agents. So they should not be used only active drug against HBV, okay? Because of the development of resistance. Emtricitabine has potentially increased antiretroviral benefits compared to lamivudine. Appears to be equally safe during pregnancy and health is a preferred option to be given when tenofovir DF in women with HBV and HIV. So if you have got an option of starting, either emtricitabine or lamivudine, always start emtricitabine. In all HIV non-immune women with HPV and HIV HAV vaccination is recommended after the first trimester as per the normal schedule, which is 0 and 6 months, unless the CD4 cell count is less than 300 cells per mm³. When an additional dose, 0, 1, 6 months, may be indicated. So remember about this vaccination, HIV vaccination that is required. One is at 0 and 6, 0 months, another is at 6 months. So one is today and another at 6 months, unless the CD4 count is less than 300. So whenever it is less than 300, give 3 doses, 0, 1, and 6 months, okay? CARP active against both HPV and HIV should be continued postpartum in all women with HPV and HIV. Hepatitis flares that occurs after delivery should be managed conservatively with careful monitoring. In the absence of obstetric complications, normal delivery can be recommended if women has fully suppressed HIV viral load on CARP, irrespective of the HPV viral load. So you may give normal delivery to these patients. Remember that. Neonatal immunization with or without hepatitis B immunoglobulin should be commenced within 24 hours of delivery. The National Infant HBV Schedule should then be followed. So remember about this thing. You may give the active immunization along with the immunoglobulin to the patient, to the baby, and should be given within 24 hours of delivery. Now, the patient is also very prone to have hepatitis C. And in this women who have this hepatitis C with HIV, on diagnosis of new HCV infection, confirmation of HCV viremia, with quantitative RNA and genotype, assessment of hepatic inflammation, fibrosis, and liver function, and concomitant liver disease should be performed. LFT should be repeated again at 2 to 4 weeks after starting the treatment to detect the evidence of hepatotoxicity or IRIS, and then monitored regularly throughout the pregnancy and postpartum. Women with both HIV and HCV should not be treated for HCV with ribavirin-based directly acting antiretroviral therapies, and all women who discover they are pregnant while receiving the treatment should discontinue HCV therapy immediately. So HCV therapy is ribavirin and should be stopped as soon as the patient becomes pregnant, or if she is already on ribavirin, she should stop it immediately. Women with both HCV and HIV of childbearing age wishing to become pregnant should be expedited to have DAA, that means directly acting antiviral based HCV therapy. Vaccination against HPV is recommended for all women with both HCV and HIV after the first trimester unless already immune. So if the patient doesn't have immunity to HPV, that means the patient has not taken vaccines for HPV before, she should have HPV vaccines when they have HCV treatment. Okay, so when they have HCV infection in pregnancy along with HIV. In all HIV non-immune women with both HCV and HIV, HAV vaccination is recommended after the first trimester as per the normal schedule, that is 0 and 6 months. Unless the CD4 cell count is less than 300 cells per mm³, when an additional dose of 0, 1, and 6 months may be indicated. So it's almost the same regimen as that of the HIV immunization, the same with HBV immunization. So start with 0 and 6 months. And if the CD4 count is less than 300, give 3 doses. In the absence of obstetric complications, normal vaginal delivery can be recommended if the woman is receiving effective CARP for HIV, irrespective of the HCV viral load. CARP should be continued postpartum in all women with both HCV and HIV, regardless of the HCV viremia fibrosis stage or CD4 cell count. So continue it in the postpartum too. Okay, so for the women who have got both the infections. Now that the antenatal management of women. Fetal ultrasound imaging should be performed as per the national guideline regardless of the maternal HIV status. So you should be doing the fetal ultrasound as we do routinely. The combined screening for fetal aneuploidies and non-invasive prenatal testing for those who screen as high risk is recommended, as this has the best sensitivity and specificity and will minimize the number of women who may need the invasive test. So specifically here in patients who have got HIV, if you go for the invasive testing, it increases the chances of transmission to the baby. And you may start or you may do the NIPT, that is non-invasive prenatal testing, for these women who seem to be very high risk for congenital anomalies or some other infections that you are thinking of, or some alloimmunizations that you're thinking of, and you want an invasive test later on for that. So never go for an invasive testing as much as possible in these women. Invasive prenatal diagnostic testing should not be performed until after the HIV status of the woman is known, and should ideally be deferred until the HIV viral load has been adequately suppressed to less than 50 HIV RNA copies. If not on cart, and the invasive diagnostic test procedure cannot be delayed until viral suppression is achieved, it is recommended that women should commence cart to include raltegravir and be given a single dose of nevirapine 2 to 4 hours prior to the procedure. So if that's the only option, the patient is not on cart and you want to do an invasive testing, this is what you should do. You should start on cart to include the raltegravir in that and give a dose of nevirapine 2 to 4 hours prior to the procedure. ECV, that means external cephalic virgin, can be offered to women when the plasma viral load is less than 50. Mode of delivery for women with CART, a decision regarding the recommended mode of delivery should be made after the review of plasma viral load at 36 weeks. Okay. For women, when the plasma viral load is less than 50 at 36 weeks and in the absence of any obstetric contraindications, you may go for a planned vaginal delivery. But for women with a plasma viral load of 550 to 399 at 36 weeks, pre-labor CS, that means PLCS, should be considered, taking into account the actual viral load, the trajectory of the viral load, the length of the time on treatment, adherence issues, obstetric factors, and the women's views. When the viral load is more than 400, PLCS, that means pre-labor cesarean section, that means elective cesarean section, is recommended. So this you have to remember. This is the most commonly asked question. So whenever it is less than 50, you may go for a normal delivery. From 50 to 399, you may still decide depending upon these factors. And more than 400, a cesarean section always. Now, management of a woman with spontaneous rupture of membrane in all cases of term pre-labor SRM, delivery should be done within 24 hours. Okay, so if the patient comes to you and she has got SRM and she is pre-labor, delivery should happen within 24 hours. If the maternal HIV viral load is less than 50, immediate induction or augmentation is recommended in women who have pre-labor SRM with low threshold for treatment of intrapartum paresthesia. So where you want to go for a vaginal delivery, it's possible, you may start with the induction as soon as possible. Obstetric management should aim for delivery within 24 hours of SROM. So remember this 24 hours for a SROM patient. For women with SROM and last minute plasma viral load of 50 to 399, immediate cesarean section is recommended, but should be taken into account the actual viral load, the trajectories, the adherence issues. We have seen all this. So you may go for a cesarean section directly, or you may just take all these things in mind and then go for the immediate skin infection. So it all depends upon what is the status of all these factors at the time when the patient's viral load is in between borderline, that is 50 to 390. For women with SROM and maternal HIV viral load of more than 400, it's as we have seen, caesarean section always. Management of preterm SROM at more than 34 weeks is the same as that of term SROM, except that women at 34 to 37 weeks of gestation will require Group B streptococcus prophylaxis in line with the national guidelines. So this is basically the same as that for other women, and we have seen that whenever it is in preterm cases, specifically here, we do the Group B streptococcus. When premature SROM occurs less than 34 weeks, what do we do? We give the intramuscular steroids. We do the viral load. If it is not controlled, then it should be optimized, and multidisciplinary team management about the timing and the mode of the delivery should be undertaken. Okay. Going ahead with the use of intravenous infusion of zidovudine. Again, this is a very, very important part. Do not forget this. Intrapartum intravenous zidovudine infusion is recommended in the following circumstances, where for women with a viral load of more than 1000 HIV RNA copies per ml plasma who present in labor or with SRO or who are not admitted for pre-labor caesarean infection. So you need to start them when the viral load is more than 1000. For untreated women presenting in labor, so she has someone who has come in labor or someone who has just come and shows to have spontaneous rupture of membrane and whom current viral load is not known. And the use of intravenous zidovudine infusion can be considered in women on card with plasma HIV viral load between 50 and 1000 HIV RNA copies. Okay, so these are the three indications where intrapartum intravenous zidovudine infusion is recommended. Okay, when the viral load is more than 1000 and the patient comes in labor or SROM or admitted for caesarean, when the patient is untreated before the labor, and when the use of intravenous, it should be considered whenever the patient is having the viral load of 50 to 1000 HIV RNA copies. Now, a little bit about the place of birth. All women living with HIV are recommended to give birth in the facilities that has direct access to the pediatric care. Okay. Water birth, there is scanty safety evidence to support the water birth in women living with HIV. However, women who chooses a water birth should be supported to achieve this where the viral load is less than 50. Now we have come to the neonatal management. Now the babies can be of different categories. They may be very low risk, they may be low risk, high risk. Again, this part is new in the guideline, and try and remember this part. So very low risk babies, 2 weeks of zidovudine monotherapy is recommended if all of the following criteria are met. Which are they? The woman has been on card for longer than 10 weeks. Two documented maternal HIV viral loads are less than 50 HIV RNA during the pregnancy, at least 4 weeks apart. And the maternal HIV viral load is less than 50 HIV RNA at or after 36 weeks. So these are very low risk babies. What are the low risk babies? When it extends to 4 weeks of zidovudine monotherapy. Okay, so those who are low risk baby the treatment is extend the treatment. So for very low risk, it was 2 weeks. For low risk, it is 4 weeks of zidovudine monotherapy. Now, if the criteria are not fulfilled, but maternal HIV viral load is less than 15 at or after 36 weeks, if the infant is born prematurely, but most recent maternal HIV viral load is less than 50 copies, RNA copies that are there. Okay, so you will have to extend to 4 weeks of zidovudine therapy if these are the things, and these are the areas which are considered babies which are considered low risk. Now, which one are the high risk and what is the treatment? Use combination PEP if the maternal birth HIV viral load is known to be or likely to be more than 50 HIV RNA copies per ml on day of birth. If uncertainty about the maternal adherence or if viral load is not known. So these are the high-risk babies whose mother don't know about the viral load or in cases where the mother doesn't comply with the drugs. Neonatal PEP should be commenced as soon as possible after birth, at least within 4 hours. Remember this. In context of known maternal resistance to zidovudine with very low risk or low risk, zidovudine monotherapy is still recommended for infant PEP. So remember about the zidovudine monotherapy specifically in very low risk and low risk. In high risk, combination PEP and there is indicated and there is history of documented maternal zidovudine and or nevirapine resistance, seek expert advice. If advice is not immediately available, commence standard 3-drug PEP until guidance is provided, that is zidovudine, lamivudine, and nevirapine. So this is a three-drug PEP that is to be given to high-risk babies, zidovudine, lamivudine, nevirapine. Now, infant PEP and HIV-2, if the woman is known to have HIV-2 infection, follow the above advice as for HIV, infant PEP, but if high risk, that where combination PEP is indicated, nevirapine will not be effective. So here you need an expert. We have seen for HIV-2, you always require an expert. If advice is not immediately available, commence zidovudine, lamivudine, and raltegravir until the guidance is available. So see how there is a change in the drugs there. Infant PEP should not be given beyond 4 weeks. PEP should not be started unless significant subsequent exposure has happened. What is significant subsequent exposure? That is viral load detectable in the mother during breastfeeding. Seek expert advice regarding the need of PEP following the breast milk exposure during the episode of maternal viremia. Now there is again this infection which comes up every time, the opportunistic one, that is pneumocystis carinii pneumonia, which what is the prophylaxis for that? Clotrimoxazole prophylaxis is recommended 1 month of age. From 1 month of age, if HIV PCR screening is positive at any stage or if the infant is confirmed to be diagnosed with HIV. This should only be stopped if HIV infection is subsequently excluded. Okay, so what is the prophylaxis? Clotrimoxazole from 1 month of age if the HIV PCR screening is positive. Now about the immunization. Immunization should be given as per the national schedule. Rotavirus, the Green Book is actually the book that is for the babies, and they manage everything. They give all the immunization, whatever is given to the baby, they keep the records in that Green Book. Rotavirus vaccine is not contraindicated unless HIV diagnosis has been confirmed and the infant is severely immunosuppressed. So you may give rotavirus except for HIV positive babies, of course, if there is very low risk and low risk of HIV transmission and BCG at birth is indicated as per the UK guidelines, they should not be delayed. So you may give BCG at birth for very low risk and low risk babies. About the infant feeding, in UK and other high income settings, the safest way to feed in infants born to women with HIV is the formula milk, as there is no ongoing risk of HIV exposure after birth. We therefore continue to recommend that women living with HIV feed their babies with formula. Abstaining the breastfeeding can have financial and psychological repercussions for women requiring support from HIV MDD. Okay. Women advised not to breastfeed for their baby's health should be provided the free formula feed to minimize vertical transmission of HIV. What about the suppression of lactation? Women not breastfeeding their infant by choice or because of the viral load when it is more than 50 HIV RNA copies, they should be offered cabergoline to suppress the lactation. So what is the basic thing? They ask the women to go for formula milk. Sometimes it can be a really distressing situation to get formula milk, so they should be given free formula milk. Okay. Whenever the viral load is less than 50 HIV, the patient may be given an option to breastfeed. Okay. But you have to keep on monitoring the mother and the baby all the time. Choosing to breastfeed in UK, women who are virologically suppressed on birth with good adherence and who choose to breastfeed should be supported to do so, but should be informed about the low risk of transmission of HIV through breastfeeding in this situation and the requirement for extra maternal and infant clinical monitoring. So we already have seen this, that they may be given an option, but you need to keep monitoring. When a woman decides to breastfeed, she and her infant should be reviewed monthly in clinic for HIV RNA viral load and for 2 months after stopping the breastfeeding. So when she's breastfeeding, every month, both of them, and then for 2 months after stopping the breastfeeding. Maternal guard is advised to minimize HIV transmission through breastfeeding and safeguard the woman's health. Now, a little bit about the diagnosis of infant, whether the infant has got HIV or not. So when will you do the test? Molecular diagnostics of HIV should be performed on the following occasions. When? So when the babies are non-breastfed, it should be done during the first 48 hours, that means the first 2 days and prior to the hospital discharge. If high risk, at 2 weeks, so remember, first 48 hours, then in high risk, 2 weeks of age, at 6 weeks, or at least 2 weeks after the cessation of infant prophylaxis, at 12 weeks, or at least 8 weeks after the cessation of infant prophylaxis, on other occasions, if additional risk. HIV antibody testing or seroconversion should be checked at age of 18 to 24 months. BIVA guideline on duration of PEP have changed for very low risk infants. So actually this was the thing for all the infants before, but now they have changed it to the breastfeeding and non-breastfeeding infants as well as the low risk and high risk women, babies. So first thing is, when the baby is not breastfed, do it molecular diagnostic test for the baby, do it two days. Before the discharge from the hospital, and in high risk, we have seen 2 weeks. And the baby is 2 weeks of age, when the baby is 6 weeks, when again at 12 weeks, and at other occasions, if there is any additional risk that has come up, and HIV antibody specifically should be done at 18 to 24 months. Now, in breastfeeding women, during the first 48 hours and prior to the hospital discharge, same, at 2 weeks of age, then it should be done monthly for the duration of breastfeeding. We have just seen that. Then again, at 4 weeks and 8 weeks after the cessation of breastfeeding, and HIV antibody again at 18 to 24 months. The neonatal management in maternal hepatitis co-infection follow the guideline for management of maternal HBV in pregnancy and for the prevention of transmission of HIV in infant. Follow usual practice of investigation and management of the maternal HCV in pregnancy. In HIV exposed but infected, this is new, so it is HEU. In light of evidence for the possible increased infectious morbidity in HIV exposed but uninfected children, timely routine vaccination should be ensured, and general practitioners, health visitors, secondary care physicians should be made aware of the possible increased risk in order to inform the decisions when assessing the risk in primary care. So always keep on monitoring these babies who are exposed but not infected. Now about the postpartum management. All on antiretroviral therapy, all women are recommended to continue the CART postpartum. We have seen this. The support services, women should be given support and they should be assessed postpartum and be referred if required to, and should be given the appropriate services in the trust community and voluntary groups without any delay. Postnatal follow-up of women should be done and should be reviewed by the named member of multidisciplinary team within 4 to 6 weeks postpartum. Now, but the mental health assessment and support, women should have their mental health needs assessed postpartum, and those assessed as having mental health issues should be referred. They should be given the appropriate care by the voluntary groups and the community. About the contraception needs to be discussed with all women, and the CART may be changed to optimize the women's contraception choice as long as the ART prescribed is fully active against the viral genotype. About the cervical cytology, they have said that it should be scheduled 3 months post-delivery as per the guidelines of NHS cervical screening program. So we know that during pregnancy, we try and defer that cervical cytology unless it's really required 3 months after the delivery. Testing of a partner, older children, for women newly diagnosed with HIV in pregnancy, testing of a partner should be completed. So this is about HIV in pregnancy. These are the few very important recommendations that have been highlighted. And if you know this well, if you read this once or twice, you will remember everything. Don't worry, though it seems to be a very big guideline, you will be able to cover it. And I'm sure that like we have treated HIV and like